If you'd like to take your Bibles and open them at Nehemiah 11, we're going to be looking at chapters 11 and 12 together this morning. And we'll come to those names in a moment or two. When Titanic left Southampton on the 10th of April 1912 to sail to New York, there were over 2,000 people on board. The passenger log was more than 50 pages long and brought together an amazing selection of people. They were divided, first of all, into three groups according to the price of their ticket, their wealth, and their social class. These three groups were then subdivided into over 20 separate lists. Those traveling in first class included lists of the aristocracy on board, the businessmen, the politicians, the high-ranking military personnel, industrialists, the bankers, and even some professional athletes. Those traveling in second class were listed as professors, authors, doctors, journalists, lawyers, clergymen, and tourists. And the third class, or steerage passengers, were mostly made up of servants, governesses, nannies, nursemaids, and immigrants moving to the US in order to start a new life. The lists of all the crew on board were equally diverse. There were the ship's officers, including the captain, the deck crew, the engine crew, the ship's stewards, the caterers, the restaurant staff, the shipbuilders, the telegram operators, and the eight members of the ship's orchestra. Lists are important. They are designed to give us information in an easily digestible form. And if we know that we're supposed to be on a particular list, then it's natural to want to check and make sure. So if I was to project onto the screens beside me a list of everybody here today, I wonder, whose name would you look for first? You'd look for your own, right? And just to make sure that you'd been included on that list. If I was to put up a list of all the American states represented here, well, I'd reckon you'd look for yours first of all. And if I was to put up a list of all the nations here today, well, you've guessed it, I think you'd look for your own first. So when it comes to these lists of names in the Bible, we shouldn't skip over them or think that they're unimportant. The names may be pretty unfamiliar to us, but of course they record real people and real events. And in Nehemiah, we've seen quite a few of them already. If you cast your mind back to chapter 3, which gave us a list of all those who repaired the walls of Jerusalem. And then in chapter 7, well, that gave us a list of the people who returned from exile. Now, if you'd been one of the builders of the wall or one of the people who'd come back from exile, you'd be pretty concerned that your name was recorded on one of those lists. Chapter 10 gave us the names of all the leaders who added their seals to the binding agreement made after the reading of the law. If you'd been one of those leaders, you'd want your name to be recorded on that list. And here in chapters 11 and 12, we have even more lists. Let me give you a bit of a taster as I read from Nehemiah 11 and verses 1 to 6. Now the leaders of the people settled in Jerusalem. The rest of the people cast lots to bring one out of every 10 of them to live in Jerusalem, the holy city, while the remaining 9 were to stay in their own towns. The people commended all who volunteered to live in Jerusalem. These are the provincial leaders who settled in Jerusalem. Now some Israelites, priests, Levites, temple servants, and descendants of Solomon's servants lived in the towns of Judah, each on their own property in various towns, while other people from both Judah and Benjamin lived in Jerusalem. From the descendants of Judah, Athaiah, son of Uzziah, the son of Zechariah, the son of Amariah, the son of Shephatiah, the son of Mahalalel, a descendant of Perez, and Marcia, son of Barush, the son of Colossae, the son of Hazaiah, the son of Adoniah, the son of Joarib, the son of Zechariah, a descendant of Shelah. The descendants of Perez who lived in Jerusalem totaled and 68 men of standing. And so the list continued, with the descendants of Benjamin in verse 7, the priests in verse 10, the Levites in verse 15, one of whom was called the son of Bunny. Bunny, isn't that a great name? I bet he had lots of fun with that one. And then, of course, the gatekeepers are listed in verse 19. These are all the people who volunteered or were chosen to live in the city of Jerusalem. A few years ago, I was in Washington, D.C., and had the opportunity to visit the Vietnam Veterans Memorial with a friend who had lost her brother in the conflict. She had been there many times before, but wanted to show me where Scott was listed on the memorial wall. And if you've been there, then you'll know that the names are not listed alphabetically, as with most other war memorials, but rather chronologically, according to the date that they fell. With over 58,000 names listed on the wall, it would have taken me a very long time to locate his name. But of course, Deb knew exactly where to find it. But that's what happens when you're connected to someone whose name is on a list. And here in Nehemiah, it would have been no different. For generations to come, people would scroll through these lists and see where their fathers, their grandfathers, and their great-grandfathers were mentioned. But we need to remember that these lists are not just recorded for future generations to look at and take pride in their ancestry. Rather, they are an enduring testimony to God's continuing faithfulness to his covenant promises. Think for a moment of the promises that God made to Abraham back in Genesis 12, that Abraham would have many descendants who would become a great nation, living in their own land and enjoying God's blessing and rule. Those promises are still being worked out here in Nehemiah. Or think of the promises that God made to his people in Babylon, for example, in Ezekiel 36, that he would bring the exile to an end and bring them back into their own land, that he would give them new hearts and put his spirit within them so that they could follow his decrees and keep his laws. Those promises are starting to be fulfilled here as well. So these lists are part of the Bible's testimony to God's ongoing faithfulness. He had brought his people back from exile. The temple had been restored. The walls of Jerusalem had been rebuilt. And they had recommitted themselves to the covenant, to obeying God's laws, and also to the temple, the focus of their covenant relationship with him. This was a time of rededication and renewal. And if you'd been there, you would have wanted your name on one of these lists. Well, if we look at these chapters as a whole, then they describe for us the practical consequences of the people's renewed commitment. First of all, in the repopulation of Jerusalem and the surrounding areas, which we're going to look at, and the section runs from the beginning of chapter 11 right through to 12:26. Then we see their renewed commitment in the rededication of the city wall, which is the passage that Jenny's going to be looking at. And then finally, in the reorganization of the temple storerooms, which Kathleen will look at. But here in this section, we see their renewed commitment is demonstrated by the repopulation of Jerusalem. Now, back in chapter 7, we're told that the city was large and spacious, but entirely derelict. There were very few people living in it, and the houses hadn't yet been rebuilt. But if the city was to be fully restored, it needed people living there. It was a hugely significant place for the covenant community of God's people. It housed the temple, the place where God dwelt amongst his people, where his word was read and taught, and where the offerings and sacrifices were made. But for all of this to happen, people needed to be living there. Well, let's take a closer look at these verses to see who was involved in the repopulation of this wonderful city and why it was so important that they were there. chapter 11 starts off in verses 1 and 2 and tells us that some of the leaders were already living in Jerusalem. Others were decided by casting of lots, and some volunteered to live there and were especially commended for that. In total, 10% of the people who had returned from exile were chosen to live in the city of Jerusalem. And it would have been costly for them to do so. The city was certainly large enough, but it was derelict, and the houses needed rebuilding. There was a lot of hard work to be done, but these people were willing to move there. That's what happens when God's word is at work in his people. They're willing to make sacrifices. Verse 3 tells us that there were provincial leaders in Jerusalem, as well as the men from the tribe of Judah, listed in verses 4 to 6, and the tribe of Benjamin, listed in verses 7 to 9. Now, these two tribes were the ones that had formed the southern kingdom after Israel had divided into two during the reign of Rehoboam. The kings of the southern kingdom had all come from David's line, and broadly speaking, had kept the temple as the focus of their covenant life together, at least until the exile. God's kindness to his people meant that his promises to King David are still intact. There would one day be a king from the tribe of Judah, born in David's line, who would defeat God's enemies once and for all, and whose kingdom would never end. The good news from this little list of people in Nehemiah is that those promises to King David still stand. Now then, verses 10 to 14 list all the priests who were living in Jerusalem. These people were responsible for all the work inside the temple. This included presenting the daily offerings and sacrifices, keeping the Sabbath regulations, performing all the ritual purifications, and the running of the sacred assemblies and the annual festivals, the festival of Passover, the Day of Atonement, and the Feast of Tabernacles. Verses 15 to 18 then list all the Levites who were living in Jerusalem. Now, these were the people who were in charge of work outside of the house of God. They included the scribes and the teachers of the law who led the people in thanksgiving and prayer. They were responsible for instructing the people and making God's word clear to them. And we saw that back in chapter 8. Verse 19 mentions the gatekeepers who were responsible for the upkeep of the temple gates and for making sure that no one entered the wrong area of the temple by accident. You'll know that the temple itself was made up of four courts and two inner chambers, and there were strict regulations regarding who could gain access into each area. Now, the outer court, the court of the Gentiles, was open to anyone. The next court in was the court of women and was open to all the Israelites, including the women and the children. The next court in was open to the Israelite men who were the heads of all the families. But the fourth court, the innermost court, well, that was open only to the priests, dominated by an enormous bronze altar. It was here that the daily offerings and sacrifices were made. But inside the innermost chamber, there were two additional chambers. The outer chamber was the holy place, which contained the golden ark of incense. And the inner chamber, the most holy place, well, that contained the Ark of the Covenant. Only the high priest was allowed to enter this innermost chamber. And even then, he could only do it on one day a year, the Day of Atonement. Why was the most holy place so off limits? Because this was where God dwelt by his Spirit. This was the focal point of the city of Jerusalem, the focal point of the temple, and all the other chambers and courts were arranged around it. God was living in the midst of his people, but direct access into his presence was forbidden, except for the high priest, on just one day a year. Okay, so these then are the people who lived in the city of Jerusalem. But what about the rest of this section? Well, let me try and summarize it for you.
Chapter 11, verses 20 to 24, lists the residents of the surrounding towns of Judah, which included the temple servants, the singers and musicians responsible for services in the house of God. And verses 25 through to 36 then lists the names of the villages of Judah to the south of Jerusalem and the villages of Benjamin to the north of the city. So important was this phase of Israel's history that people's names and the places where they lived were recorded for posterity. But it's clear that the city of Jerusalem, and in particular the temple, are the main focus here. All the roles mentioned in these verses have something to do with the work inside the temple. The gatekeepers, the singers, the musicians, the scribes, the Levites, the priests. And this is then further emphasized by the list of all the priests and Levites recorded for us in chapter 12. First of all, in verses 1 to 11, during the days of Jeshua, who was most probably the high priest when the temple was being rebuilt. And then in verses 12 to 26, during the days of Jehoiakim, his son, who was most likely high priest after him. Well, let's take a step back from the specific details of these lists and think for a moment about the bigger picture. What are we to make of these lists of names and places and roles? Well, I think there are two things. First of all, we should take note of their joyful anticipation as God's promises are being fulfilled. This is undoubtedly a new chapter for the people of God. Exiled in Babylon for 70 years, they had no place of their own to live in, and because the sacrificial system had been suspended, they had no way of preserving their covenant relationship with God. But now, with the restoration of the temple in Jerusalem and the rebuilding of the walls around Jerusalem, the people of God have returned to the city of God. God's word is at the heart of their communal life together, and the sacrificial system is once again up and running. God has been faithful to his promises and has brought his people back from exile, back into their own land, back into covenant relationship with him, just as he said he would. No wonder they rejoiced at this time. But not only that, the people of God have listened to the word of God and have committed themselves to obeying that word. And it was costly to do that. But one of the fruits of their renewed commitment is seen in their willingness to start all over, to make sacrifices, and to move into this great city. There's a really good vibe in all of these verses. The city of Jerusalem is springing back to life again, and the people of God are seeing God's covenant faithfulness at work. His promises are starting to be fulfilled. But for those of us who live the other side of the cross, who have even more evidence of God's faithfulness to his promises, doesn't this mean that our joy and our anticipation should be even greater than theirs? Which leads me to my second point. We've seen their joyful anticipation as God's promises are being fulfilled. But this should lead to our joyful realization that God's promises have been fulfilled in the Lord Jesus Christ. At this point in salvation history, everything is still geared around the temple, the place of God-ordained worship and God-ordained sacrifice. The people of God are once again enjoying the benefits of their covenant relationship. But we need to remember that although they enjoyed access to God through the priests and through the sacrificial system, they did not have direct access into his presence. The temple was the means by which sinful people could be brought back into relationship with a holy God. But direct access into his presence was not possible because of their sin. The entrance to the most holy place had an enormous curtain in front of it. The restoration of the temple meant that they could once again come near to God, but not that near. How much more, therefore, should we rejoice at God's covenant faithfulness? Because his promises have been fulfilled in the Lord Jesus Christ. He is the mediator of the new covenant. He is our great high priest, who has gone into the very throne room of heaven itself, and with his blood has provided the one true sacrifice for sin. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 4, tells us that it is impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins. But when the Lord Jesus died, he took the punishment that should have been ours. He propitiated God's wrath and dealt with all our sins. So Hebrews 10, verse 10 tells us that we have been made holy through the sacrifice of the body of Jesus Christ once and for all. The temple curtain has been torn down from top to bottom, and he has opened up the way for us to enjoy direct access into God's presence. God's promises of a return from exile were only partially fulfilled in Nehemiah's generation. But Jesus' death has opened up the way into God's presence. So Hebrews 10, verse 19. Since we have confidence to enter the most holy place by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way opened up for us through the curtain, and since we have a great high priest over the house of God, let us draw near to God with full assurance of faith. A few years ago, we had an American family attending my church back in the UK who used to live in DC. Mike had worked at the White House during the Bush administration, and reckoned that there were about 17 different security checks that he had to go through before he got anywhere near the Oval Office. He worked for the president, but he couldn't just waltz into his office. He didn't have that kind of access. But do you remember those iconic photos of JFK at his desk in the Oval Office and John Jr. playing at his feet? John Jr. didn't have to go through 17 security checks. He had direct access into his Father's presence. And so it is with Christ. He had direct access into the throne room of heaven, and by his blood, he has opened up direct access for us all. All those who returned from exile in Babylon shared a moment of joy in Jerusalem, but as we shall see, it was only fleeting. How much more, therefore, should we rejoice and give thanks because we have the permanent solution to the problem of sin and Jesus has opened up direct access into his presence? They shared a moment of joy in Jerusalem. We look forward to an eternity of joy with all God's people in the New Jerusalem. On the 15th of April 1912, after Titanic had sank, there was only one list of names, the list of known survivors. It didn't matter what list your name had been on at the start of that journey. The only list that really mattered was the list of those who lived after it. And whatever list your name may have been on in the past, your Sunday school attendance list, your high school graduation list, your college roll of honor. The only list that really matters is the list of all the inhabitants of the New Jerusalem. And one day, that roll call is going to be one that we're all party to. And boy, are you going to listen out for your name. The Lord Jesus made it possible for our names to be included on that list. But here, back in Nehemiah, the people had recommitted themselves to the covenant and to the repopulation of Jerusalem. And that was the first practical consequence of their renewed commitment, their willingness to move into the derelict city and rebuild it, and their renewed confidence that God would be faithful to his promises were very evident. God had started something new, and they eagerly anticipated the fulfillment of all his promises. Well, with all of this in place, they were ready for the next stage of their renewal. So over to Jenny for that.
Well, if you keep your Bibles open to Nehemiah chapters 11 and 12, this is part two. Just get myself organised here. So we've been reminded of the joyful anticipation of a new start in the holy city. The word of God is once again at the centre of the community. The temple and the sacrificial system is up and running, and the city has new inhabitants. And now we come to verses 27 to 43 of chapter 12, and we read of the people dedicating the wall of Jerusalem to God. And there is great joy because of God's faithfulness. Let me read some of these verses for the sake of time. I won't read all, that's my excuse. There are some funny names in there as well. So I will skip over some and I'll let you know where I'm going to touch down again. So starting at verse 27 of chapter 12, and at the dedication of the wall of Jerusalem, they sought the Levites in all their places to bring them to Jerusalem to celebrate the dedication with gladness, with thanksgivings and with singing, with cymbals, harps and lyres. And the sons of the singers gathered together from the district surrounding Jerusalem. And then verse 30, and the priests and the Levites purified themselves, and they purified the people and the gates and the wall. Then I, that is Nehemiah, brought the leaders of Judah up onto the wall and appointed two great choirs that gave thanks. One went to the south on the wall to the Dung Gate. And after them went Hoshea and half of the leaders of Judah. Verse 35, with the musical instruments of David, the man of God. And verse 36, and Ezra the scribe went before them. At the fountain gate they went up straight before them by the stairs of the city of David, at the ascent of the wall above the house of David to the water gate on the east. The other choir of those who gave thanks went to the north, and I followed them with half of the people on the wall above the Tower of the Ovens to the broad wall, and above the gate of Ephraim, and by the gate of Yeshanah, and by the fish gate, and the Tower of Hananel, and the Tower of the Hundred to the sheep gate. And they came to a halt at the gate of the guard. So both choirs of those who gave thanks stood in the house of God, and I and half the officials with me, and the priests, and there are the names there, verse 42, and the singers sang with Jezrahiah as their leader. And they offered great sacrifices that day and rejoiced, for God had made them rejoice with great joy. The women and children also rejoiced, and the joy of Jerusalem was heard from far away. Now, if we were to sum up this section here in chapter 12 in one word, I think a good word would be joy. But there's no sense here of we better be joyful, or I suppose we should be joyful. They're not being told to be joyful. They are joyful. To tell people, these people to be joyful as they were about to dedicate the wall, it would be a bit like on someone's wedding day, the bride is beautifully dressed and a friend tells the bride as she comes out of the church, rejoice. Or a midwife telling a first-time dad with his newborn baby in his arms, now I want you to rejoice about this. Or a mum telling her child to be joyful as she puts a bowl of ice cream down before him when he was expecting fruit for dessert. Now, these are ridiculous scenarios because the joy that is experienced is simply a natural response. There's no need to urge them to be joyful. There's no need to say, rejoice. They already are. That's the sense of this passage as the people dedicate the wall of Jerusalem to the Lord. And yet, I wonder, even as I'm speaking, that you're thinking, well, we don't always feel joyful. I know God wants me to be joyful. I know I should be joyful. I don't always feel joyful. Is it a matter of just gritting our teeth and doing it, you know, being joyful? How is joy fostered among God's people? I want us to be thinking, having that question in our minds as we look at this passage, work through it. We're going to work through it, and then we're going to think about what we learn and then how we put these things into practice for ourselves as we think about God's people and how to be joyful, what it means to be joyful. If we go to the end of this particular part of chapter 12 in verse 43, we read that the people of God rejoiced with great joy, and the joy was heard from far away. Now, what brought them to this point of being able to rejoice in this way? Because it's been quite an up and down, as we heard last night, up and down journey for them. It has been quite a journey. If we go all the way back to chapter 1 that we looked at about 3 weeks ago, no, it wasn't, it was 2 days ago. It feels like longer than 2 days, don't you think? So all the way back to chapter 1, we remember we read about Nehemiah, and he heard the news that those who had returned to Jerusalem and Judah were in great trouble and shame. The wall of Jerusalem was broken down, its gates destroyed. But as we've worked through Nehemiah, we've read that despite hardship and opposition from surrounding peoples, problems from within the community, here they were, the walls built, the city repopulated, the word of God at the center of the community, read, explained, and understood. It's been a long, hard slog, lots of setbacks, opposition, disappointments, but now finally here they were. Everything was coming together. The day of dedication had arrived. Now, how are they going to prepare for a day like this? Well, we read, have a look at verse 27. We read that the Levites were brought into the city. Apart from those who'd moved in, as Carrie explained to us just now, who'd moved in and lived in Jerusalem, the community of God's people lived in villages outside of Jerusalem. This included the Levites. But now, on this great day, the Levites are being brought in. And in fact, others are being brought in too. Have a look at verses 27 to 29. We read that the Levites, the singers, the musicians, all came together to lead the people in worship, to celebrate with gladness, with thanksgiving, with singing and cymbals and harps and lyres. Here was a people getting ready, preparing to celebrate. Now, how are they going to prepare for a day like today? They're going to bring the people in. And in verse 30, we read that the priests and the Levites purified themselves and also purified the people and the gates and the wall. Now, I don't know what picture you get here. Perhaps you get a picture of a big spring clean, getting everything spick and span, shiny and clean for the big day. But it's not quite like that. This is purification, which was more about preparing to come into the presence of the Holy One, preparing to approach God. And it's not clear in this passage exactly what that purification involved. Perhaps it involved ritual washing of themselves and their clothes. Perhaps it involved fasting. Perhaps it involved abstaining from sex. It might have involved sacrifices. It really isn't spelt out. It might have been like when the people were being prepared to meet Yahweh at Mount Sinai in Exodus. Here they were preparing to come into the presence of the Lord to celebrate with great joy. The priests, the Levites, the people, the walls, the gate, the holy city, described in Nehemiah as the holy city, is being prepared. That was the point of the purifying. And then we read in verses 31 to 39 of two choirs that formed a procession on the wall itself. Now, what would that have looked like? Have you ever seen a choir all garbed up, all highly organized, all in position, all singing their hearts out in beautiful harmony? Or perhaps a picture that comes to mind is of those marching bands who are moving as one, playing. I don't know how they do that. How do they march and play and keep moving in that the way that they do, with great pride and practiced choreography? Perhaps we bring those two pictures together and then add some, and that will help us to imagine what this procession on the wall of Jerusalem would have looked like. Now, there were two choirs. One choir was accompanied by Ezra the scribe, and we read here, have a look at verses 31 to 37. We read how they proceeded south on the wall to the dung gate. They probably started out at the valley gate and they ended up at the water gate. In verses 38 to 39, we read of the other choir that was accompanied by Nehemiah. And this procession headed in the opposite direction, heading north. So if you can picture the wall, and sometimes our Bibles have those diagrams for us, you can picture one group heading south and one group heading north, and they're heading towards the gate of the guard. And so we have this great procession that is not quite, but nearly encircling the whole city. Now, imagine that. Imagine the spectacle. What a sight to inspire celebration for all the people. And for those who were there and those who had eyes to see and hearts that marveled, the sight and the mention of these gates and these walls, the dung gate and the fountain gate and the fish gate or the water gate or any of the other gates and parts of the wall would have brought back for them fresh memories of their work. Remember, they were involved in this. An amazing community event, not without danger, but with a leader, Nehemiah, who knew the good hand of God upon their work. And remember how we read earlier in Nehemiah, how he prayed and then he acted in faith to do God's will. See, these are a memory, they're remembering what has happened. It's like, you know, when you smell a certain fragrance and it reminds you of a person or a time or a place, or you hear a certain song and it takes you back to a certain time, or you look at some photos and it reminds you of people or emotions or a holiday or a time. For the people of God here in the holy city, seeing this procession of Levites and priests and singers and leaders on the wall, a wall that was so recently broken down, but now built, perhaps using their own hands, would have filled these people's hearts with joy. What were they looking at when they looked up at this wall with these people? They were looking at God's faithfulness. And did you notice that in these verses we read of Nehemiah in the first person, in verses 31 and 38 and 40, something that we haven't seen since chapter 7. This is the man who not so long ago was inspecting this broken down wall at night and who oversaw the building, the rebuilding of this wall in 52 days. And here they are, gathered together with a procession on the wall. A wall that Sanballat and Tobiah said not even a fox could go on without breaking it down. Here is this procession on the wall giving thanks to God. And as we read this description of the procession, just like all of God's word, there is nothing casual or random here. There is a beauty and a symbolism in how this procession is described. For example, did you notice that David is mentioned? The mention of David is not incidental. He's mentioned in terms of musical instruments, verse 36, the stairs of the city of David, above the house of David, verse 37. Again, evoking memories of God's faithfulness to promises made to his anointed king. And just like the names, the list of names that Carrie highlighted in chapter 11 and 12, there are more lists here in this particular part of Nehemiah. For example, we read in verse 35 of Zechariah, who can trace his ancestry all the way back to Asaph, one of the leaders of worship in the time of King David. In other words, what we see here is what we see in all of God's word. There is a continuity, there is a consistency, there is a continuity of leadership that takes us back to the promises made to Abraham, that point us forward to Abraham's seed, Jesus Christ. It's beautiful, that arc of redemptive history that takes us to the cross. And the sight of this procession, this continuity of God's promises to his people, would have made the hearts of the people there swell with joy. What were they looking at? The faithfulness of the Lord. And they were singing. And now, what were they singing? Perhaps they were singing Psalm 48. Let me read some parts of Psalm 48, and you'll see why this would be very appropriate for a day like this. Walk about Zion, go around her, number her towers, consider well her ramparts, go through her citadels, that you may tell the next generation that this is God. Our God, forever and ever, he will guide us forever. They're fitting words, aren't they, for what they're doing here? A day of celebrating God's faithfulness. This is our God. Our God forever and ever. The procession finishes in the temple. Have a look at verse 40. We read, so both choirs of those who gave thanks stood in the house of God. There they were gathered. The priests offered great sacrifices and all the people celebrated with great joy. So there's something wonderfully climactic about these verses. Everything feels, what feels like it's been leading up to this very moment, all the work of God, using leaders like Zerubbabel, Jeshua, Ezra, Nehemiah, re-establishing temple worship, renewing his covenant through the preaching of his word. And verse 43, they offered great sacrifices that day and rejoiced, for God had made them rejoice with joy. The women and children also rejoiced. And the joy of Jerusalem was heard far away. Did you notice in that one verse that the word joy or rejoice is repeated 5 times in one verse? Joy expressed in praise and thanksgiving and sacrifices and singing. Joy expressed by everyone, leaders, singers, priests, Levites, women and children. Everyone was involved as they celebrated with great joy. This was a high point. We're going to have some other low points, but this is a high point in the history of God's people. And they've had other high points too. Back in Ezra chapter 3, when they dedicated the laying of the foundation of the temple. Ezra chapter 6, where they dedicated the temple. In Nehemiah chapter 8, when they rejoiced when they understood the words that were being declared to them. So there have been great times of rejoicing, sometimes mixed with sadness. But this day there was no sadness in the mix. And the joy of Jerusalem could be heard far away. It'd be like if you were in Brazil and you weren't in one of the stadiums of the World Cup, but you've got Chile and Brazil playing against each other. You would have heard a great roar from the stadium for one of the teams. Who was knocked out? I forget. Chile was knocked out, so they wouldn't have been cheering, but the Brazilians would have been cheering. It'd be a little bit like that. The roar of the crowd that could be heard from far away, the joy that was being expressed that could be heard from far away. What a day. If you had to sum up these verses in one word, it would be joy. Let's get back to that question I asked in the beginning. What do we learn about joy, and how is joy, in the light of this passage, how is joy fostered in God's people? I want to say 3 things as we finish this part. Firstly, we learn that joy is God-centered. It comes from being in the presence of God, gathered together. They were gathered together in the temple, purified, together giving thanks to him. Verse 43, God had made them rejoice with great joy. Not only does joy come from being in God's presence, but it actually comes from him. He is the source of their joy as they worshipped him. And it's the same for us. Joy is fostered by gathering together as God's people with God at the center. But what is different for us is that it's no longer about meeting in a place. It's about a person. Jesus Christ. Joy is fostered in knowing the very presence of God and the Lord Jesus and enjoying that together, gathering together, week by week, gathering together at places like this, 4,000 people gathered together, enjoying what we have in Christ, sisters in Christ worshipping together. Joy is fostered as we enjoy a God-centered joy. Secondly, we learn that joy comes in remembering God's faithfulness. As the choirs and the leaders proceeded around the wall, all who were there would have been remembered that the Lord had protected them, enabled them to finish. Not so long ago, the wall was broken down, the city was empty, the word was not heard or understood. Now look. Joy is fostered as God's people remember his faithfulness. And we need to do that as well. We need to remember God's faithfulness. And how much more do we have to remember that our God has given us his Son, Jesus Christ, our great high priest who has provided a new and living way, who has given us his Holy Spirit, who is the guarantee of our inheritance, that's in Ephesians chapter 1, who's given us his word to live by. How easy is it for us to forget? How easy is it for us to become consumed by the stuff of life, the good stuff, the hard stuff of life? Joy comes in remembering God's faithfulness. How are we going to remember that? Jerry Bridges talks about preaching the gospel to ourselves. That is, every day reminding ourselves of who we are and what we have in Christ. Packer, in his book Knowing God, writes about who we are and what we have in Christ this way. He says, and this is what we can remind ourselves of: I am a child of God. God is my Father. Heaven is my home. Every day is one day nearer. My Saviour is my brother. And every Christian is my brother and sister too. See, we can remember God's faithfulness by remembering the truths of the gospel and daily saturating our hearts and our minds in God's word. Like dunking our heart and our mind in a bucket of God's word and saturating it into our hearts and our minds so that we think the very words of God after him. Making it our default. Talking with each other, reminding each other of God's works day by day. That's how we remember his faithfulness. That is how joy is fostered. And finally, thirdly, we learn that joy is fostered when there is a focus on thankfulness. Here we have God's people celebrating the dedication of the wall with thanksgiving in verse 27. The choirs themselves are described as companies which give thanks. In the original, it is one word. They are thanksgivings. It's like one thanksgiving went to the north, one thanksgiving went to the south. It's the choirs were the embodiment of what they were singing, thanksgiving. Thankfulness fosters joy. And if the people of God in Jerusalem were consumed by thankfulness, how much more for us who sit this side of the cross? How much more for us who know God's faithfulness in the Lord Jesus Christ? Being thankful fosters joy. I have some friends who have been working as missionaries in Southeast Asia, and they have had to come home due to serious illness. But in one of their prayer letters, they were writing about thankfulness. And let me just quote what they wrote in this particular prayer letter as a great example of thankfulness. So I'm quoting now. After reading a really fantastic book called 1,000 Gifts, we've been inspired to keep a family Thanksgiving journal, and it has truly brought great joy to think of all the ways that we've been blessed, both big and small. We're up to 361 gifts we're thankful for at the moment, and we're aiming for 1,000. And when we reach 1,000, we're going to celebrate. Here are some things that are featured in our Thanksgiving journal. I've changed the names, by the way. Daddy feeling well enough to take James to school. Falling asleep when it's raining. Fresh lettuce growing in our garden. A nice cup of Earl Grey tea in the morning. Friends bringing gifts of eggs from their own chickens. Emily's fat rolls on her thighs. Emily's a baby, by the way. There comes a time when you cease to give thanks for that. These people, these friends of mine, have faced some really difficult circumstances, but this is a family that is joyful. They know the joy of the Lord, and they're expressing that joy in thankfulness for all that God has blessed them with. Being joyful. You don't have to tell a bride on her wedding day. You don't have to tell a new parent as they look at their newborn baby. You don't have to tell a child with a big bowl of ice cream. And you didn't have to tell the people of God in Jerusalem to rejoice with great joy. They just did, because God had made them rejoice. They were God's people. They were amongst God's people. They were in the presence of God with a joy that was God-centered, because it was all about what God had done. How much more for us? And they offered great sacrifices that day and rejoiced, for God had made them rejoice with great joy. The women and children also rejoiced, and the joy of Jerusalem was heard far away.
We are seeing this morning what happens when God works in his people through his word. We're seeing the fruit of revival, of renewed covenant commitment. So what have we seen so far? Carrie showed us a people ready to move in and repopulate Jerusalem. When God works in a people through his word, first, we see they're ready to move. Second, Jenny showed us a people ready to rejoice. That repopulated city began to ring with joyful worship that echoed far. When God works in a people through his word, even as we're experiencing here together, it brings the kind of joy we spend a lot of our lives longing for. And now, because they're so full of joyful worship, finally we see a people ready to order their lives to keep it going. Does that sound a little anticlimactic? After such grand celebration, the joyful songs are still echoing, and then right away in verse 44, on that day, it says, we're told they do what? What's the marvelous end to this marvelous passage? They get organized. They put structures, they put disciplines in place. That does sound a little anticlimactic. But it's actually beautiful. It's surprisingly beautiful. Here's the thing. We don't live our daily lives in a grand climax of celebration, do we? We will someday. Someday when there's no night, only the light of the Lamb and the New Jerusalem shining like brilliant gems. Don't you long for that day? But now we are still on the way to that day, and we have to go home on this day after all our joyful worship together. But we go home with God's word to light the way and to show us as God's people how to order our lives to keep the worship going day by day until that day. Martin Luther said there were only 2 days on his calendar, this day and that day. In this final section of Nehemiah 12, which is, it sort of feels like a postscript to the worship scene we've just relished, we see that when God is at work in a people, they're ready not only to move, not only to rejoice in the most joyful worship, but now also to order their lives to keep the worship going. Let's just read this little passage starting in verse 44. On that day, men were appointed over the storerooms, the contributions, the first fruits, and the tithes to gather into them the portions required by the law for the priests and for the Levites according to the fields of the towns. For Judah rejoiced over the priests and the Levites who ministered. And they performed the service of their God and the service of purification, as did the singers and the gatekeepers, according to the command of David and his son Solomon. For long ago, in the days of David and Asaph, there were directors of the singers, and there were songs of praise and thanksgiving to God. And all Israel, in the days of Zerubbabel and in the days of Nehemiah, gave the daily portions for the singers and the gatekeepers, and they set apart that which was for the Levites, and the Levites set apart that which was for the sons of Aaron. let's make three quick observations from these verses about just how these people are ordering their lives. First, God's people are ordering their lives together according to God's word. They're not making this up as they go. Rather, they're instituting worship practices that verse 44 tells us are required by the law. That is, they were set forth by Moses in the Pentateuch as God's prescribed rituals of worship. The law is full of instruction about bringing the best of the first fruits of the land into the house of the Lord. Deuteronomy 26, Moses gives a beautiful review of how the people should gather their harvest first fruits in a basket, carry it to the priest, who then takes the basket and sets it down before the altar of the Lord, all the while rehearsing God's faithfulness in bringing them out of slavery and into this rich land. Last night in chapter 10, we saw the people covenanting to bring these offerings, and here they are getting it organized. These regular offerings and contributions were kept in various storerooms and carefully apportioned to the priests and the Levites, who were then supported and enabled to devote themselves to their worship duties. So in verse 45, here are the priests and Levites at work performing the service of their God and the service of purification. We just glimpsed those purification rituals. Remember back in verse 30, there were many such rituals required to purify the people from all sorts of uncleanness over and over and over. And sacrifices were regularly offered as well. The temple was to be a constantly active center of life and focus for God's people. Here in verse 45 come also these singers and gatekeepers, following the practices begun back in the time of David and Solomon. And finally in this passage, everybody's involved. Did you hear it? All Israel, verse 47. All Israel giving the daily portions and offerings, which were divided up and allotted according to the practices prescribed in the law. It is quite a system, isn't it? This is a huge enterprise, this temple-centered worship, and God obviously cares about every detail of it. The Old Testament is full of it, full of the ways God provided for his people to come into his presence and worship him. The people here are honoring God by taking such care to order these practices he prescribed. Think about that grand worship celebration we just read about. That represented, think of it, a gigantic reorganizing effort begun back under Zerubbabel, according to verse 47. Zerubbabel, remember, who led the first group of freed exiles back to Jerusalem about 100 years before this, who paved the way by rebuilding the temple and reinstituting these temple practices. And now here's Nehemiah carrying it on, cementing these practices, all of it as required by the law. We have seen, haven't we, that Nehemiah is a man of the word. And here under his leadership, all the momentum of that grand worship is gathered up and carried on in these ordered practices, ordered according to God's word. This first observation, that God's people order their lives together according to God's word, speaks right into our lives. For one thing, it reminds us that we are instructed as God's people to order ourselves. The Apostle Paul talks about things in the church being done decently and in order. And Paul spends a lot of time in the epistles explaining how God's people, now called the church, we'll talk about that in a moment, are to be ordered so that robust worship of the Lord Jesus can grow and spread. The structured organization of the church is not exactly a welcome idea these days in a lot of circles. Have you sensed or have you felt this anti-institutional mentality that's just tired of formal organizational structures and just longs for good personal interaction? Kevin DeYoung and Ted Kluck wrote a great book about this with a sort of wonderfully in-your-face title. It's called Why We Love the Church, In Praise of Institutions and Organized Religion. In that book, they respond biblically to this cultural dissing of, as they say, the organizational, institutional, hierarchical, programmatic, weekly services view of church. A lot of people would just really rather read their Bibles with a friend over coffee, or maybe just get a group together on the spot and see how the Spirit leads, or maybe just listen online to a good sermon. And are you doing that right now? This is not a sermon. This is a good blog, maybe, and post a few comments. In fact, we probably need to do more reading the Bible with people over coffee, meeting with groups to talk and pray, and a great blog is great. The point here is that what confronts us in Scripture from beginning to end is God's call to his people to order their lives around regular worship practices, regular gathering together with carefully appointed and qualified leaders, faithful financial contributions and accounting of these contributions, organized care for the needy, often musical praise and worship, and always front and center what? The reading and teaching of God's word. Through these kinds of structures, the joyful enthusiasm of God's people can be not only carried on, but also passed on to others, to the next generations. We just read in Psalm 48 about that. Without these kinds of structures, passing it on often just doesn't happen. Many of us probably know the temptation to let our busyness pull us away from regular connection with the structures of church life, with its disciplines of meeting together and serving one another, with active respect for leadership. All this takes huge commitment, doesn't it? As we order our lives around these God-ordained means by which God blesses and grows his people. Some of us might struggle to connect not so much with the church, but sometimes within the church. That is, to find the most fruitful place as women to serve within the structure of leadership that we want to support with lives of faith and love and holiness with self-control. This can be challenging. But what is it that motivates and empowers us today to meet this challenge of connecting ourselves well within the order of God's people? Here's the beautiful advantage we have. We are not fitting ourselves into a system of temple regulations that point toward a promise, as we've seen in Nehemiah. We believe on this side of the cross that we are made part of a living thing, a body, Christ's body, a living temple of his presence. So this may be challenging, but this is our life. So let's keep on actively loving the church. Let's keep on loving the church because we love the head of the church, who is Christ, who gave himself up for us and who makes us beautiful. That's what the word tells us. For love of him, we believers order ourselves as his people according to his word. My husband Neil and I both grew up in families who loved the church, who were involved in church families. We have tried to analyze what it was that kept us from getting burnt out, you know, as they say, or hypercritical, and we have concluded that our families simply really did love the church, delight in God's people, because at heart they loved the Lord of the church, and it was catching. This is one of the joys of serving at TGC, a ministry that does not compete with the church, but aims to serve the church by serving leaders and members of the church. This is one of the joys of this conference, that we women who come from churches all over the world, think of it. I'm thinking of the conversations I've had in the last hours. Last night, there was a lovely group of women from Wasilla, Alaska, gathered up here. And then there was in the hall, yeah, there you are. And then there was in the hallway a group from Dubai, and then a lovely woman from Paris, and then three women from Indonesia, and then women from here in Orlando. Think of all the churches represented, or perhaps if you don't have a church with which you're connected, you might go home and find one. And our prayer is that we would go back to churches encouraged, and we pray a bit more equipped to love and serve the church, really living out this wonderful pattern of God's ordered people that we glimpse here in this passage. So, first observation, then, God's people are ordering their lives according to God's word. The second observation follows logically. God's people are ordering their lives depending on his promises. This part of the book, Jenny talked about it, has King David on its mind, doesn't it? David, the man of God, we saw it in verse 24, 36, 37. We've seen here in verse 45, the singers and the gatekeepers following what David and Solomon set up. And then again in verse 46, do you see it? We return to David's history. For long ago, it says in the days of David and Asaph, there were directors of the singers and songs of praise and thanksgiving to God. So, why all these mentions of David? Just like the people have been recording all these names, faithfully tracing the promised seed of Abraham, let's say it one more time, so here as they keep tracing this link to King David, they're not just holding on to traditions, they're actually putting themselves in the stream of God's promises. David was a key figure in the unfolding of God's promises. And these people knew that, especially as they collected and sang the Psalms during this period, the Psalms which are full of these promises. Psalm 89, for example, 89:3, you have said, I have made a covenant with my chosen one. I have sworn to David, my servant, I will establish your offspring forever and build your throne through all generations. So as the people sing the songs of David and follow the worship practices of David and highlight the fact that they are doing so, these people are setting themselves in a stream of promise, a covenant stream. The stream does not look so promising at this point. They don't even have their own king anymore, right? But here they are setting the temple back in motion, following God's word, keeping King David in their sights. They are, in effect, putting their faith in God's promises, even when the fulfillment is invisible. This second observation also speaks right into our lives right now, challenging us to ask what we're depending on as we order ourselves in the church right now. What's our worship all about? Is it about our own experience right now? Or do we get how we fit into this larger story? Do we grasp that we as God's people are recipients of this long stream of promises, a covenant stream that flows right to Jesus? The book of Nehemiah really helps us here, doesn't it? So we see these people continually looking back over their history. We begin to see that this is our history too, and that we in the church today are incredibly privileged to live in the part of the story where the promises have been fulfilled and are now flowing fast to the end. We get to sing about the promised King Jesus, Son of David, who came, and we sing too about his coming again. We have the final and full orchestral version of songs of praise and thanksgiving to God. Let's don't forget why we sing. As God's people, we sing not just for the satisfaction of our own emotional expression. We sing ultimately to declare and celebrate God's glorious promises, all fulfilled in his glorious Son. That's why we sing. We're in a long line of faithful singers, we in the church today, a line that stretches ahead to the climax when the music will burst from all corners of heaven and earth and under the earth. What a wonder to be part of it. What a joy. That's the third observation, joy. More joy. These people were ordering their lives, one, according to the word of God, two, depending on the promises of God, and three, with joy. This final section is all about ordering their lives, yes, but it's not just a matter of legalistic rules, is it? Did you hear those words go by at the end of verse 44? After all the categories of offerings and workers, did you hear it? For Judah rejoiced over the priests and the Levites who ministered. This joy, of course, doesn't jump out and surprise us here in the text. The word joy has been woven into the whole book. Think about it. Into that amazing Bible study scene of chapter 8. I loved it, Nancy. The joy of the Lord. Well, she can do it better than I can. And then in the joyful worship, whose echoes have not even yet died away as we read these verses. That joy just kind of leaps naturally into this next section, and all this order according to the law actually becomes a source of continuing joy. Think of how the people might have chafed under the laws at this point. They were poor. They really needed to get to their own farms and get their houses in order. What a drain to spend so much time and effort on all these temple goings-on, all these complicated different offerings and tithes. Or think of the temple workers themselves. Don't you wonder if they were tempted to complain about God's ordering of them? Only one tribe, as you know, was designated by God to work in the temple, the tribe of Levi, and only one branch of that tribe could be priests, the descendants of Aaron, Moses' brother, the first high priest. Only Aaron's descendants could be priests. The rest were Levitical workers. Now, how was that fair? I bet some of the non-Levites wished they could do what the Levites were called to do. And I bet some of the Levites who weren't in Aaron's line wished they could be priests. And probably some of them would have made better priests than some of the sons of Aaron. All this ordering, we can chafe at it, can't we? Or we can rejoice in it. That's the other option. It's a much better option. Because it opens up the blessing of joy that comes in following God's order according to his word. God's order is beautiful because he's God. He's the God who made order from the beginning. When he took that formless void and he said, let there be light. And then he separated the light from the darkness. And he called the light day and the darkness night. And set the sun to rule the day and the moon to rule the night. And on in this whole progression of order that when we embrace it gives us the greatest joy. God's order is beautiful because he is God. This picture of God's people worshiping according to his order and finding joy in it is hugely instructive for us. It is so easy to chafe against God's order in all kinds of ways. It's just our natural bent. But it's not the direction of joy. The direction of joy is to look deeply into God's word, to put our faith in the promises of that word, and then to rejoice as God's people in obeying that word. Of course, this joy isn't just for us. Ultimately, it brings glory to God who receives the praise of our joyful songs. And then this joy draws others. Remember, it rings out of Jerusalem. It's heard from afar. This joy is meant to rise up and to spread out. It's not just for us. It's meant to spread out ultimately from Jerusalem into Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. There's one more thing to say. You know what it is. We've seen this morning that when God works in his people through his word, they're ready to move, they're ready to rejoice in joyful worship, and they're ready to order their lives to keep that worship going. What else do we need to say? We need to say that these people couldn't do it. They saw it, they aimed for it, and there was this one brief shining moment of joy in Jerusalem that lets us glimpse it. Like a lot of other shining moments in the Old Testament that let us just glimpse what it looks like when God's people worship him wholeheartedly. But chapter 13 looms ominously ahead. It's good that we've still got chapter 13 to go. Because it will remind us that that history of repeated rebellion is still repeating. Nehemiah will leave us longing for the Savior, clinging for the Savior who came and made an end to that endless cycle of rebellion we saw last night by applying the ultimately merciful solution of the cross. All these talks on Nehemiah, I'm sure you've noticed it, have sent us finally to the cross, haven't they? There's nowhere else to go. Nowhere but to Jesus who died, Jesus who rose, Jesus who's coming again. But let's don't forget these chapters 11 and 12 as we go on. The fact that these people will blow it in chapter 13 does not mean we should minimize or leave behind the magnificent worship, the order, the joy. These are glimpses, these are true glimpses of what happens when God's word works in a people. These are glimpses of what Nehemiah is all about, and that's God's faithfulness to his people and his call for their faithful response to him. The whole story is not over in Nehemiah's time, But these are glimpses we can hold on to and that pull our gaze ahead toward what we'll be doing forever as the bride of Christ in that perfectly ordered New Jerusalem. What will it be? That city with foundations whose designer and builder is God. It will be filled with inhabitants who've moved in by God's grace. It will ring with joy, joyful worship of the Lamb. And all that are there, all who are there in perfect order around the throne, will cast their crowns before the throne and bring offerings of praise and adoration, worship. In Nehemiah, we glimpse the city. In Christ, we take up residence in this city. One day, soon, this city's going to come down out of heaven from God. Let's pray. Thank you, Lord God, for making us your people through your Son. Make us ready to move by your Spirit. Make us ready to rejoice with joy in worshiping our risen Savior. Make us a people beautifully ordered by your word, a church whose one foundation is Jesus Christ, our Lord. In his name we pray. Amen.